White Fragility, it's a book by former corporate consultant Robin DiAngelo, ascended the publishing charts very quickly in light of recent protests. But now it is having its message, let's say, re-examined, or at least examined for the first time. And friend of the show, journalist Matt Taibbi, he remarked this book, quote, reduces everything, even the smallest and most innocent human interactions, to racial power contests.
And Matt joins us now via Skype to elaborate on his piece.
That's right. Good to see you, Matt. How are you?
Good to see you both.
Yep. Absolutely. Ryan, so Tiger, Matt, Matt, as you said, you're on the verge of getting canceled again for daring to go after this White Fragility book. What is it about? I mean, you wrote just an incredible scathing takedown of it. But what is it about the work itself that you find most morally objectionable?
So it's funny, if you took parts of the book and just looked at the areas where she's trying to bring the attention of white people to structural inequities, to different kinds of situations that they might not be aware of, because being white, you're raised in a situation where you're simply not aware of certain factors. All those things are very positive. The problem is she has this other, she wraps it up in this all-encompassing theory that basically says that the people are defined by their race or by the perception of their race, that these categories are inflexible, and that the only thing you can hope to do to combat the ongoing problem of racism is to relentlessly focus on race and commit to a lifelong program of striving to be less white, which it's a very strange theology, which is, I guess, becoming sort of academic mainstream now. But the book itself has a lot of very odd theories connected to some pretty uncontroversial and positive theories.
Mm-hmm. You know, when I saw that book hit number one on the New York Times bestseller list in the wake of these protests, I remember thinking to myself, oh boy, people are going to actually take a look at this book. And then it's going to be interesting.
Yeah.
And right. You know, there are some odd academic strains that are running through this. But Matt, talk a little bit about the corporate strains running through this, because this flows out of the kind of corporate diversity industrial complex,
yes,
so to speak. And, you know, she is a corporate consultant who is brought in to train corporate employees on how to interact in a corporate workplace on behalf of corporations. In other words, her job is to, you know, make the corporation a better place. Have you ever interacted with any of these consultants? Do you know much about this industry?
I don't know a whole lot about this industry. I have encountered this kind of person a couple of times, but not, I have to say, admit, not extensively. But you're right, there's a couple of things going on here. First, the extraordinary irony of white America in the wake of this racial tragedy in Minneapolis elevating, of all things, a white corporate consultant to number one on the Amazon bestseller list, because this is how they want to reinterpret their racial issues. But you're right. This is the racism problem as seen through the lens of somebody who makes thousands of dollars an hour being hired by companies to address, normally it's to address an internal toxicity issue. So what they do is they bring in these people who come from, you know, various academic outposts, and they bring teams in and they have trainings where they facilitate anti-racism dialogues, and employees are sort of herded into these trainings and forced to listen to these speeches. And that's the lens through which her theories come. This is how corporate America views the race problem. It views it as an individual issue that where racism is sort of inexorably stuck in all of us, and the only way that we can combat it is through relentlessly listening to corporate consultants tell us how to fight it. And
right,
that's the irony here, is that I think the problem with this book ultimately is that this is the corporate vision of how to tackle racism. It's just to hire people like this to run through every company and search out racism in every corner, which could mean a thousand different things that aren't necessarily good.
Right, that's what I find so objectionable about it too. Can you describe, my favorite part of your piece is about the Jackie Robinson section and about how DiAngelo rewrites history based on Jackie Robinson in order to cast it in this new theology and image. I just think it's a perfect encapsulation of how destructive this ideology is.
Yeah, it was very odd. I almost wondered whether the book had an editor, because she wrote this section about Jackie Robinson, and her point was the Jackie Robinson story was a myth that white America shared, that he was an exceptional ball player, and essentially the legend was that he was the first black man who was able to play with whites, play baseball with white people on the merits, and mm-hmm. that his story had invisibilized white racism, racist structures, and privilege, which is the exact opposite of what that story means to basically everybody who's ever encountered that story. In fact, I think I would argue that the Jackie Robinson story is probably the first way that most non-academic Americans were introduced to the concept of privilege, because this was a story about a whole generation of mediocre white ball players who were, you know, sort of unfairly elevated to positions that they otherwise would have been displaced from by superior black ball players who were being kept in the Negro Leagues. So the story means exactly the opposite of what she thinks it does.
Right.
But it's very, very strange that you know, I think one of the things that happens is when you're in an echo chamber academically and nobody around you is disagreeing with you all the time, you can see your theory everywhere and just never have anybody disagree with it.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, and I wanted to pick on something you mentioned earlier, that, you know, these corporate consultants are brought in after some toxic event takes place inside a corporation that leads to complaints. And so at this point, the corporation is, you know, essentially trying to stamp out whatever protest it is they're getting from within that corporation, rather than trying to kind of meet the demands of whatever that protester had said. And so they think, if we let them talk long enough, maybe this will fizzle out and talk in different ways. What do you think the actual end goal of establishing these ideas is for these companies and for, you know, the authors of these mm-hmm. kinds of books?
Well, I think broadly speaking, corporations would much rather bring in people like this to essentially, you're right. Usually the story is they're getting a complaint either from the outside or from the inside about a toxic situation within the workplace. So what do they do to remedy it? They agree to bring in an outside consultant and do a review and then conduct training. And they pay enormous sums of money to these academics who come in. And so the corporation wants a gold star that it can show to the public to say that it's fixed its problem. But it also sets up a new culture wherein essentially there's sort of a permanent ongoing review of the entire company. And that can also have utility because it's a very useful way of getting rid of troublesome employees. Internal complaints that anonymously can be sent to all sorts of people. But I think more broadly speaking, the problem is that corporate America would much rather deal with the racism problem in this manner than do things like, I don't know, give Medicare for all or do other
right.
structural reforms that would be much more difficult, much more painful. Here they can handle racism as an HR issue and just by hiring a, you know, a high-priced consultant.
I think you are hitting exactly the nail on the head, which is that Amazon will take the deal every day of the week to be able to hire Robin DiAngelo and put Black Lives Matter banner up at the top, as long as they don't have to actually pay their black working class workers
exactly.
more, or if, you know, face tough questions about how they treat their workforce. So thank you for spotlighting an issue like this, Matt. We really appreciate you joining the show.
No, thanks very much. Hope to talk
Absolutely.
To you soon.
Absolutely. We'll have more Rising for you after this.